way to being free.
Hey, what's going on, guys? It's me, Bart, and that's the Xiaomi Mi A1 in my hands. I've been using one for almost a full month now, actually exactly a full month now, and I guess my experiences with the same will be basically everything you would need to know about the Mi A1. So it's clearly an attempt to revive the Android One program that was born in 2014 and also died in 2014, but this time it's actually even more simpler. Google's software, packaged in hardware made intact by Xiaomi, has capabilities of reaching more people than any other hardware, at least in India, keeping the future in mind, which is saying a lot. And this is the result of the collaboration, the Mi A1, which is getting sold out in less than a second apparently. But in my time with this, I really found this to be a mixed bag. Like, my opinions on the hardware on the outside are nothing new, I've had these before. Meaning the design itself is nothing new. Like those enormous bezels at the front flanking that display, not new. The same very boring antenna line structure from last year, not new. That pretty big form factor overall, not new.
But it's not bad at all, it's just boring.
It's actually constructed and finished really well, so it's like one singular slab of metal without any plastic plates at the top or bottom, but with those beautiful shiny chamfered edges all across the border and also on the buttons. Speaking of which, you know I happen to have an OCD for tactile buttons, but I can't lie, these didn't really match up to the benchmark Xiaomi created itself with the Redmi 4. But I'm pretty sure that's mostly me, and almost everyone will be fine with these. But I actually really like the feel of the phone. It's completely metallic, as I said, so just as premium as a high-end flagship. And both the colors, the black and the gold, do a pretty good job at hiding the fingerprints, although you still can see them through certain angles. Oh, and this does not feel very fragile, but it actually is. I've seen people take on social media to share their experiences of how the glass on top of the display broke by a tiny fall. And even I have a tiny dent on the bottom corner through a very minor impact. So you don't want that to happen to you, hence I would recommend investing in a good case for this. In fact, not just a case, but also a good screen protector, since the front has oleophobic coating which tends to get slippery. I also wish there were some front firing speakers, since it has such huge bezels, but the speaker at the bottom gets pretty loud and does perform pretty well. Other than this, it also finally now has Type-C port at the bottom, which still a lot of manufacturers haven't started incorporating into their hardware. There is also an IR blaster at the top for you to control your appliances. And the headphone jack thankfully is all alive and is positioned at a very sweet spot at the bottom. As far as the colors are concerned, I'm definitely going for the black one, always in team black. But fun fact, the gold Mi A1 is the first gold colored phone that I've used as my daily phone. And the word that describes this the best is fresh. I think it's mainly due to the white front married with pure Android that gives it a really pleasant vibe. Maybe it's just me, but I spend quality time with both the colors and that's what I feel. Although one of the major reasons why I would go with the black one, of course apart from those sexy looks, would be to avoid that always shining black inner bezels around that display on the white one. It always seeks my attention and I'm just not able to connect with the stuff on the screen sometimes. Again, maybe it's just me and maybe you can get over this, but the black one with the black front totally hides it and it's much better in my opinion. And there is also a lot of confusion regarding which device is manufactured where. So the gold one is made in India, basically assembled in India, whereas the black one was initially made in China, but now it's starting to be assembled in India also, which is great, although there is no price difference at all. Speaking of media consumption, the display is a 5.5-inch 1080p IPS panel with pretty good viewing angles until you really reach out for the extremes. But it has 450 nits of brightness, which might seem less, but it's actually almost always visible outdoors. The saturation is also pretty accurate for me, although I wish it was slightly more contrasty than what it is right now. But since this is 1080p, you get quite a lot of pixels every single inch, 403 to be precise. And it's nothing pentile, so it's very crisp, and you can tell by looking at the logo of the Pure VPN app, it's definitely really crisp. Oh, and speaking of PureVPN, they were kind enough to sponsor this video. PureVPN helps you in a lot of ways, like overcoming restrictions imposed by the school or at work or by your ISP. You can access your blocked websites, social media accounts and apps in any country of the world. Plus, you no longer need to worry about hackers trying to steal your data over public Wi-Fi or malware attacking your device. Most of all, it is equally easy to set up across all the major platforms, devices, and operating systems. It's too good to miss. I'll leave it linked below. But one of the two main attractions of the Mi A1 is the software. And since it is Google's department to handle, we have pure Android, which means we finally have an app drawer and also those smooth animations with a really fresh, really clean look. Basically an unaltered set of codes in the software. It does have a few Xiaomi apps built in as bloat, but if you don't want to use them, they stay out of your way and don't hinder in the performance. And as of now, it's on the very latest of Nougat, which is 7.1.2, with a promised update to Oreo by the end of this year. Although this version itself has a couple of glitches here and there. Like for example, the unlock transition is just too slow when your device is sleeping. I actually initially thought that the fingerprint sensor itself was slow, but it actually scans your fingerprint with even the most minimum duration of contact, like pretty much less than a second. But the slow transition just ruins the purpose of such a speed of scanning. Also, since the phone is so long, thanks to the big screen and enormous bezels, I would have really liked if I could have pulled the notification panel down from swiping anywhere on the home screen. Although you can swipe down on the fingerprint sensor to pull it down or push it up, but that's not always the most practical thing in my opinion. Also, when you double press the power button to launch the camera while it's asleep, it first displays a white screen and then gets you into the camera. So it almost takes a solid second, sometimes even more than that, for the camera to launch, which sometimes is just enough for the moment to pass away. And the Mi A1 on the software front also misses out on a couple of things. Like it does not come up with a native FM support. So if you're into radio, you're out of luck. And also since the Mi A1 does not have NFC, it lacks out on features like Android Pay, which might not be a big deal, but skipping out on NFC also makes you lose features like Android Beam. But truth be told, most of these issues won't really be of huge concern to most of the people. And as far as the glitches are concerned, the software team back at Google is actually pretty consistent with software updates. I've already had one, although that didn't really fix a lot of these issues. But I guess they really increased the frame rate of the animations all across the software. It's just buttery smooth now. Although sometimes you do get to witness a couple of stutters or lags or minor hiccups here and there. But again, software updates should basically heal all of these wounds. But one thing that has been consistently good is the performance. It has a Snapdragon 625 and it basically never disappointed. I played some really high-end games on this, like Real Racing 3, which was really fun. Of course, not the most frames per second, but I honestly could not expect more considering the price. And almost always I used to have LTE toggled on and it barely got warm, which was really impressive considering the fact that it's all metal. The Mi A1 also has 4 gigs of RAM. And in my usage, I basically almost always had more than a gigabyte free, so it might seem like it's almost unnecessary, but I guess that would really come in handy in the future. Oh, and also the background app refresh limit is pretty impressive. Another thing that's impressive is the battery life. Now this has an almost 3100 mAh battery, which might seem like a poor use of space, considering the fact that it's bigger than the Redmi Note 4 and has a much smaller battery. But this is not bad, not bad at all. It's actually really great. It's got an amazing standby time. I remember I slept at 100% one day and woke up at 96. And then secondly, it's also got a great screen on time of about 4 to 5 hours. And this is coming after a really heavy usage with LTE toggled on for quite a lot of hours straight. Gaming and always being on social media, watching YouTube videos, just being very hard on it. Although this officially does not support fast charging, but it charges completely in about 2 hours or so, and I personally don't have any problems with that. But finally, let's talk about the most hyped up aspect of the Mi A1, the camera. So both the lenses at the rear are 12 megapixel lenses, with one at 26 millimeters of focal length and an aperture of 2.2, and the telephoto lens at 50 millimeters of focal length and f-stop of 2.6. I personally think that the camera is the biggest mixed bag in the entire phone. It does a few things really well, but then it misses out at those things that you wouldn't have imagined going wrong in a 2017 budget flagship. Firstly, the app itself is pretty nice, like it should be. It's decently fast and snappy, very easy to use, and does have some pretty nice filters that don't really blow everything up. Oh, and how can I miss the manual mode? It's pretty convenient. It basically gives you everything in your control, does not skip out on anything. Although one big downside of this manual mode is that you can't monitor the changes live in the viewfinder. So sometimes it will be like a hit and trial process, since you would have to go back and forth between the gallery app and the camera app to achieve the result that you want to achieve. But as far as the images are concerned, both the lenses actually perform pretty well when clicked in broad daylight. Again, as they should. Great colors, pretty accurate saturation levels, which actually match real life scenarios. Also got great detail and really crisp. In fact, I've been using this as my Instagram camera for quite a lot of time now, posting a lot of stories with this. Make sure to follow me there if you want to see some more photos and posts clicked with the Mi A1. I'll leave my profile linked below. But coming back to the photos themselves, although they are pretty impressive, the camera does tend to blow up the highlights in a couple of scenarios, which means it also struggles with dynamic range. It sort of is hard for this to differentiate between the darkest and the brightest areas in the same frame. There is, however, a noticeable difference when HDR is toggled on, but you would always have to be attentive for dynamic range since it does not support auto HDR, which is disappointing. Oh, and also just think twice before shooting with this in low light. I mean, it is basically unusable in dim light at nights or in dark areas. The camera automatically amps up the ISO so much that the result is just a really grainy image overall. But the best part about this camera is ironically the portrait mode, which not a lot of cameras get right. I think that the separation between the subject and the background is pretty impressive, just makes the subject pop. Almost feels like it's artificial, but it really is very convincing to look at. Oh, however, this too does not work in low light at all. As far as the video is concerned, technically it's capable of shooting 4K, but it has neither OIS nor EIS, so you basically end up with a pretty shaky, unstable, not so pleasing to look at video overall. You should probably avoid that. Oh, and if you're wondering, the front camera of this phone is just a rotten potato. But that's about it. That's what I feel about the camera and the entire package itself. Can't really call this the best budget smartphone Xiaomi has ever made. I think one of the biggest competitors to the Mi A1, apart from the Moto G5 S Plus, is the Redmi Note 4 itself. The Redmi Note 4, apart from the software and the camera, is basically the same phone. Same specs, pretty much the same great build quality, same screen size but a smaller body and a bigger battery, and all of this at a much cost-effective price tag. But since most of the issues with the Mi A1 can be fixed with software updates, it can actually pay its way all the way to the top, and hopefully it will. If you want, maybe I can do a revisited video on the Mi A1 maybe at the end of this year to check out its progress. Let me know what you feel about this. And also let me know what you think about this video itself. One of my great friends, Harshit, helped me shoot this video and also got me the Black Mi A1, which was super sweet of him. So make sure to check him out. He also does some tech reviews. I'll leave his channel linked below. But that's been it. Thanks for watching. Stick around and take care.